So we missed the recording for first 10 minutes and then, okay, we're going to continue from here and hopefully it will be recorded now. So as far as the member of plateal means are concerned, plate means flat, helminths mean worms. They are flat worms. They include both free living species as well as the parasitic species. They have bilateral symmetry. That's another important factor that distinguishes them. And it's the first phylum of the triploblastic animals. So normally they originate from three germ layers, ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm. And from plateal, means if you move forward to the higher phylums, like nematodes, like arthropods, and then we have the chordates, they all are triploblastic. And then there is one very, very important thing. They either have epidermis or tegument as outer covering. And when we will discuss the plateal means in more detail, you will going to realize that tegument is a very, very important character for parasites that facilitates their survival as well as that facilitates the repair if some damage is caused by the immune system. So one very, very prominent surface feature is that as far as the free living species are concerned, they have epidermis on their surface. While the parasitic species, they have tegument, as they are all acoelomate. So that's once again, it's a distinguishing factor. So being bilaterally symmetrical, this differentiate them from all those which have radial symmetry or pentaradial symmetry. Being triploblastic, distinguishing them from diploblastic animals. And the most prominent, that is, we name it as it's a synapomorphic character, it's a shared derived character that is only restricted to the members of plateal means. You cannot forget that is that they lack coelom. As far as the nematodes are concerned, it's a pseudocoelom. And every other higher phylum from nematodes, whether it's an arthropod or it's from, they are all coelomates. So when you define phylum plateal means as multicellular animals that have bilateral symmetry and that are triploblastic and they are acoelomate, there cannot be any organism in this world that do not belong to the phylum plateal means. As far as the classification of plateal means is concerned, as I told you previously, that plateal means include both free living as well as the parasitic species. So maybe during your graduation you read something about the planaria and it's a free living worm. So plateal means have one class that includes the free living members, and we name that class as the cluster bularia. And we're not going to discuss that class because we are discussing parasites, so we will simply ignore this class. The remaining three classes, whether it's a monogenia, whether it's a class trematoda or it's a cystoda, these three classes, they include all parasites. As this is a course of medical parasitology, so monogenia, they are mostly the parasites of fishes. So we're not going to discuss those parasites within this course. That's not the scope of this course. While what we will going to discuss in much, much more detail in this course will be the class trematoda and cystoda. We name trematodes as flukes. I do not think there is anyone in the class who do not know about the Fasciola apatica. It's a very, very much prominent parasite. That is from class trematoda. Another one, very, very important parasite. It's a blood fluke. Most of the species of the phylum plateal means they are monoecious, but schistosoma is one exception where you have the separate male and female. That's why that distinguishes the schistosoma. It's a very, very important parasite when it comes to the medical parasitology. Schistosoma, it stays in the blood. And there are three main species, Schistosoma hematobium, Schistosoma mansoni, and Schistosoma japonicum. We are going to discuss each and every one in much, much more detail when we're going to discuss that.
सर आपने जो डिप्लोब्लास्टिक और ट्रिप्लोब्लास्टिक टर्म बताई है ये थोड़ी एक्सप्लेन कर दें।
ओके। नॉर्मली व्हेन इट कम्स टू द डेवलपमेंटल स्टेजेस इनिशियली थ्रू दैट वीएन ऑफ द जायगोट अल्टीमेटली यू विल हैव ड्यूरिंग डेवलपमेंट थ्री मेन लेयर्स एंड आई विल ट्राई टू इंक्रीज द साइज And all of your body structures. Can you see the magnified pictures of diploblastic and triploblastic?
Yes, sir.
So all of your structures, they develop from these germline layers. They are not present in an adult animal. Rather, they are in the developmental stages. So when we talk about the phylum Celentata, they have only two layers. One is the ectoderm, and other one is the endoderm. When it comes to the, so that layer that appears something like pink and it's something purple, that is all ectoderm. And then you have another layer, we name it as the mesoderm, that is only present in triploblastic animals. While when it comes to the diploblastic animals, the second layer they have is the endoderm. And that appears yellow in this screen. Hopefully, that's quite yellow. And in between them, it's a non-cellular layer, and we name it as the mesoglia. When it comes to the triploblastic animals, those animals, they originate from three main layers. One layer that appears that is shared with the diploblastic animals that appears as pink or purple, that is an ectoderm. And then you have a layer that appears very, very dark. It's a cellular layer and we name it as the endoderm. In between the ectoderm and the endoderm, you have a layer in triploblastic animals, we name it as the mesoderm. So diploblastic animals, Celentrate is a very, very prominent example of the diploblastic animals. They develop from two germline layers, ectoderm and endoderm. While all the higher phylums, they develop from three layers, ectoderm, endoderm and mesoderm. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Lady, just feel comfortable.
Yes, sir. And, okay.
Okay. And when it comes to the, we're going to discuss later on, maybe I have another picture that within the triploblastic animal, sometime a cavity is being present. Here, as I have a picture of platyhelmin, so you do not see any cavity, any coelom, so they are acoelomate. The coelom exists between the mesoderm and the endoderm. So here, between the mesoderm and endoderm, the layer that you do not see any cavity. So we name them as the acoelomate. There is another class of animals where you will going to see a cavity that is between the mesoderm and the endoderm. And we name them as the coelomates. But in those cases, the mesoderm is being, the cavity is being entirely lined by the mesoderm. So you will have the cells of mesoderm that is surrounding that cavity from all sides. If the cavity is entirely lined by the mesoderm, we name them as coelomates. When you see the example of arthropods, even the chordates, they are all coelomates. We have one phylum where we have a false coelom. False coelom means on the outside you have a mesoderm and on the inner side you have an endoderm. So the cavity is not entirely lined by the cells of mesoderm. So we name them as is there still distortion in my voice?
No, sir, absolutely perfect.
What happened?
So clear awaaz aapki. Slides nahi.
Okay. Is it clear? Do you have any question? Please confirm so that I can continue.
No, sir. Okay.
Sir, ट्रिप्लोप्लास्टिक और डिप्लोप्लास्टिक का ब्रीफ एक बार फिर बता दें।
सो एज आई टोल्ड यू दैट एनिमल्स ड्यूरिंग द डेवलपमेंट सो ज़ाइगोट डिवाइड इनटू द फ्यू इनिशियली यू विल हैव द मोरूला एंड देन यू हैव द ब्लास्टुला एंड देन यू हैव द गैस्टुला. And guess we distinguish it by having all those three layers, or either it has two layers or it's three layers. So initially, it's a circular structure that includes the layers. And from those layers, your different structures, they will going to originate in an adult animal. So normally, diploblastic animals has only two cellular layers. And from those cells, differentiation of those cells, all those structures, they develop. So one layer we name it as the ectoderm, and another layer is we name it as the endoderm. While in case of triploblastic animal, they have their development not from two layers of cells, rather their structures, they originate from three layers: ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm. So those who have at the stage of gastrula have three layers of cells, we name them as the triploblastic. And those which have two layers of cell, we name them as diploblastic. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Just feel comfortable. If you are not clear, that's my responsibility. Just feel comfortable. If is it clear?
Yes. Yes, sir. Sir, thank you so much.
Okay. So, as far as the trematodes are concerned, I mean, we were discussing the two classes which we will be going to discuss in during this course. One are the trematodes and one are the cystodes. So, at any time when you need to classify the trematodes, you have to continue from the start that they are all multicellular, they are eukaryotic, they are heterotrophic, they have the ingestive mode of nutrition, they do not have a cell wall. These are all characters that are being shared by the animals. So you cannot differentiate the platy elements from other animals. So now you need to add the synapomorphic characters that are shared derived characters that are shared by only one group. So those unique characters that are shared only by the platy elements will be that when you use the word triploblastic, triploblastic means phylum platy elements is triploblastic, nematode is triploblastic, arthropods is triploblastic, all the chordates, they are triploblastic. So once again, when you use the term triploblastic, once again, it will differentiate the cell and traits from them, but not other phylums. From the triploblastic, you need to add another term. We name it as the acoelomate. They do not have coelom. When you use the word acoelomate, triploblastic acoelomate, that means when you talk about the nematodes, they are excluded because they have pseudocoelom. And all the higher phylum, they will be excluded because they are all coelomates. The lower phylum will be excluded because they are diploblastic. So when you use the word triploblastic and acoelomate, that means you just restrict yourself to the phylum platy elements. And there is no organism other than platy elements that will have all those characters. But within the platy elements, either it's a class Turbularia, either it's a class Monogenia, whether it's a trematode or cystodes, they all have all these characters which I have discussed right now. So now if you need to split, differentiate the trematodes from cystodes, when it comes to the trematodes, we name them as the fluke. Their structure is leaf-like. When we talk about the cystodes, they are tapeworms. Their structure is tapeworm, very, very long. When we talk about the cystodes, they have the absence of digestive tract. They do not have any digestive tract at all. So if I was going to add all these structure features, that any organism that is multicellular, eukaryotic, triploblastic, acoelomate, parasitic, and then it do not have any digestive tract. The body is divided into the head, scolex, and strobila. You will not going to find any member other than the cystodes. So once again, these are all synapomorphic characters that the last one are the synapomorphic characters that distinguish the cystodes from trematodes. That their body is tape-like, body is divided into three main regions, head, scolex, and strobila, and the last one is that they have the absence of digestive tract. When it comes to the trematodes, we have two, although we have other parasites as well, but two very prominent parasites. One is the Fasciola hepatica and other one is Schistosoma. Although you have the Chinese liver fluke as well there. When it comes to the cystodes, we have really long parasites there. I think a lot of you know about the Tinea. So Tinea normally exists in, it has two species. One is the Tinea solium and other one is the Tinea saginata. One we name it as the beef tapeworm and other one is the pork tapeworm. Maybe you heard about Diphyllobothrium latum. Another common name for it is a broadfish tapeworm. So here fish act as an intermediate host. So in this course, we're going to discuss class trematodes as well as class of cystodes. Another phylum. Yes, please. Just feel comfortable.
What's the strobila?
I haven't discussed when we're going to discuss those structures. I will going to discuss in more detail. I was just mentioning those characters for a very limited period of time. Now I'll go into that.
Okay.
Let me wait. I will going to give you a little demonstration. So normally, they have a head, and then they have a, we name it as the scolex. Mean that head has suckers that are used for attachment, and then it has a neck. These animals, and then you have the strobila. You have all those repeated reproductive units. They are all hermaphrodites, so within all that structure, and all these structures, they have both male and female reproductive organs. So we named another name for it is the proglottids. So at the from the neck, those proglottids, they emerge, and then those reproductive structure within them, they will going to mature. And eventually, once they will have the fertilization, eventually in the last few proglottids, you have nothing else but eggs. And we name those proglottids as gravid proglottids. And those proglottids, they are just nothing else but the pockets of eggs. And all those reproductive structures, which were when they emerge from the neck, what happened that they have the development of reproductive structures. So once the reproductive structure they develop, and eventually after fertilization, they have the production of eggs. And when those eggs they are produced, they are kept in all those proglottids. And you have many, many eggs, and ultimately, after some time, those reproductive structures, they will going to disintegrate. And at the end, you have nothing else that the proglottids, they are just pockets of eggs. And either those proglottids, they are shed. So they detach from the body of parasite, or those proglottids, they have an opening. Through that opening, all those eggs, they will be released outside the body of animals. So these are all proglottids, and that's about the structure of the tapeworms. A body very, very much tape-like. Body distinguished into the three regions, head, neck, and then you have all those reproductive structures. We're going to discuss in much, much more detail when we'll discuss the class histoda. Do you have any question now? Please update me so that I can continue.
Mm-hmm.
Is it clear now? Just feel comfortable.
Yes, sir.
So we just completed our discussion on cystodes, and now we're going to move to nematodes. If someone asks you about the distinguishing characters of the nematodes, they have bilateral symmetry. They are all elongated. They do not have any segmentation, and they are all cylindrical. That's why we have a name for them as roundworms. Another very important character is that they have separate sexes. They are all triploblastic, but they are pseudocoelomate. As we were discussing platyhelminths, I told you that parasites of platyhelminths, they have an outer covering. We name it as the tegument. While here they have cuticle as an outer covering. Once again, as far as the nematodes are concerned, we have free living species as well as parasitic species. The most prominent parasitic species of the nematodes is that maybe you heard about like Ascaris. It's a very, very long parasite. Then maybe you have heard about like Entrobius, pinworm. And the most specifically the species Entrobius vermicularis. No, I have recording. The lecture is being recorded. Okay. And then maybe you will have heard about the elephantiasis. It's a very, very much prominent disease. Maybe you heard about like hookworms. They are all members of the phylum nematodes. So we're going to discuss each and every in much, much more detail. And the last phylum which we're going to discuss will be the phylum Arthropoda. Once again, arthropods, jointed legs. They have an exoskeleton that is made up of chitin. They have segmented bodies. They are bilaterally symmetrical. As far as the arthropods are concerned, when it comes to their medical significance, majority of the arthropods, they are not harmful to humans. But the arthropods, they act as vector. They transmit the diseases. Black flies, they transmit the disease. Mosquito, they transmit the disease. Sand fly, they transmit the disease. Tsetse fly, they transmit the disease. So their role is more as vector of significant diseases. So we're going to discuss arthropods as vector. And secondly, we're going to discuss there are a few arthropods that act as ectoparasite that stays on skin. And one of the most prominent ectoparasite is the Sarcops cavii. I'm sure that at least someone in this class must have experienced this disease, and we name that disease as scabies. It's a contagious skin disease where you have the severe irritation on skin. And the skin becomes red, and eventually you have crested lions on your skin, especially in those regions where you have the creases, like in between your fingers, your pelvic region. And that irritation or itching becomes very, very severe at night. And at any time, if someone has experienced that disease, we name it as the scabies. If you ever visited the doctor may have told you that, okay, you just need to change your bed sheets. You just need to change your clothes, have a warm shower. And then they may have given you an ointment that, okay, you just need to cream your skin. And they will ask you to repeat all that procedure that after the application of that, first you need to take a warm shower, and then that is being followed by the application of that ointment. And then they will ask you to repeat that procedure for 3-4 days, and after that you will going to recover and you will be okay. So that is caused by a mite, and we name that mite as the Sarcops cavii. That's a very important ectoparasite when it comes to the medical parasitology. And as this mite cannot fly, it's a very small size mite. You cannot see it with naked eye. Rather, you need to take the skin scrapings and then isolate that mite from those skin scrapings. So as this mite cannot fly, so it has the ability to crawl. So when you just scratch your skin in response to the itching, you may displace or dislodge a mite, and eventually it moves. It may be fell down on bed sheets or towels or anything else, and eventually that mite can survive outside the host for maybe 3 days, and eventually it can enter into the body. It can invade the skin of another person. That's why it's very, very contagious. It's rapidly direct contact is the most effective means of transmission of that disease. So this parasite is very, very common, and it's more common in institutional settings like hostels and all those where you have the overcrowding. So that is one thing we will going to discuss. Another very common thing is that when you have the head lice infestation, we use the word infestation for ectoparasites. Once again, very, very common, but not threatening, not so much threatening. And then we're going to discuss some ticks as ectoparasites. So that concludes my discussion, that about the classification of the medically important parasite. Do you have any question regarding this? Is there any question? Can we continue? So we're going to discuss the protozoan parasites, we're going to discuss the platyhelminths, we're going to discuss the nematodes, and then we're going to discuss the arthropods, either as vectors or ectoparasites. Now I'm going to switch to another slide. So let me upload this, the second presentation. Give me a couple of minutes. Is the intestinal protozoan parasite PowerPoint presentation is visible on your screen? Please update me so that I can continue.
Yes, sir.
So, in the previous section of this lecture, I classified the parasites, and when I was classifying those parasites, I classified them on the basis that which locomotory structures they use. Either they are flagellates, either they are ciliates, either they are amoeba, or they have no structure for movement, like in case of Apicomplexa. That is one way to classify the parasite. In medical parasitology, there is another alternative available for the classification of parasites. And when I restrict myself to the protozoan parasites, another way to classify the protozoan parasite is that either they are intestinal parasites or they are bladder and tissue parasites. So two classifications. Either they are intestinal parasites or they are I'm just learning how to write using this mouse. Blood and tissue parasites. That criteria is more applied when you are discussing the protozoan parasite with reference to the infection caused by them, because it becomes very easy when you just discuss them that, okay, a list of these protozoan parasites, they causes the intestinal infection. A list of these parasite, protozoan parasite, they causes the infection either in the blood or tissues. So as it becomes more convenient to discuss all those diseases with reference to their site of infection. Because parasites, they have a specific site within the body of host. Very rarely they just display and become erratic parasites. So now we're going to start discussing the intestinal protozoan parasite. As far as the intestinal protozoan parasites are concerned, the most prominent example is the Entamoeba histolytica. It stays in the large intestine. It's an amoeba. So it has pseudopodia for movement. We have another parasite. We name it as the Giardia lamblia. Once again, it's from the phylum Sarcomastigophora, but Giardia has flagella for movement. And then we have a third parasite, very important parasite. We name it as the Balantidium coli. It's a ciliate. It uses cilia for movement. And it is causing an intestinal infection. And then we have the Cryptosporidium and the Isospora. They do not have any typical locomotory structure, rather they have apical complex and they are intracellular parasites. So they are also causing an intestinal infection. So as far as the intestine is concerned, you have a protozoan parasite that is an amoeba and it's causing an infection in your intestine. You have a parasite that is a flagellate and it's causing an infection in your intestine. You have a ciliate that is causing an infection in your intestine. And you have parasites that have apical complex for penetration, intracellular parasites that are causing intestinal infections. So this is the list of significant protozoan parasite that causes the infection in the intestine. So we're going to start our discussion with Entamoeba histolytica. As when I was discussing the significance of the parasite, I shared a table, and in that table, maybe you have seen that it this parasite causes about a few years back, it was causing about 100,000 deaths. And now approximately each year, this parasite causes about 55,000 deaths. It's a parasite that is cosmopolitan in nature, meaning it has a worldwide distribution. And this parasite is able to infect about 35 to 50 million people worldwide. As this is a disease that is more relevant for the hygienic conditions, so it's more common in developing countries and underdeveloped countries as compared to developed countries, because in developing countries we normally have poor hygienic conditions. As far as the human is concerned, this parasite has a direct life cycle. So no intermediate host, although dogs, cats, rodents may act as a reservoir host. And like all other parasites, to this point, we do not have any vaccine available, commercially available vaccine against the parasites. And we were going to discuss why we do not have any vaccine against parasites. So later on, but there is no vaccine against Entamoeba histolytica. The infection it causes, we name it as the dysentery. We have dysentery caused by bacteria as well. And maybe during the course of microbiology, you heard something about bacterial dysentery. So tell me, what is dysentery? Anyone, any volunteer from this class want to tell me about the dysentery? It is different from diarrhea. Any volunteer? Any volunteer, can you hear me? Is there any distortion in my voice? On the chat portal, someone asked me, what's the third form of leishmaniasis? One is cutaneous, other one is the mucocutaneous, and you forget your own leishmaniasis, that is the visceral leishmaniasis. Visceral, because in case of visceral leishmaniasis, it affects your visceral organ, and your visceral organs are your spleen and liver. Another name for the visceral leishmaniasis is the Kala-Azar, and it's a disease of subcontinent, India and Pakistan, Bangladesh. So it's visceral, V-I-S-C-R-A-L. Please answer, what's the difference between a diarrhea and dysentery? Can you hear me? Is there any distortion in my voice? Is there any distortion in my voice? Okay, then answer this question, please. We use the word diarrhea when you have the watery stools. दैट इज फॉर डायरिया. While in case of dysentery, there is blood and mucus in the stool. In dysentery, you have blood and mucus. So this is how you can differentiate between diarrhea and dysentery. When you have blood and mucus, just name it dysentery. So amoeba causes dysentery. That means there will be blood and mucus along with the diarrhea. Secondly, as dysentery is also caused by the bacterial infection, in case of bacterial infection, normally we relate the bacterial infection with very high fever. Okay. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you have any question? Just feel comfortable and ask. Do you have any question? So I told you that diarrhea is the watery stools. And in case of dysentery, you have blood and mucus in the stools. So amoeba causes dysentery. But you have a dysentery that is caused by the bacteria as well. One way for differential diagnosis, whether it's a dysentery caused by amoeba or it's from a dysentery that is being caused by the bacteria, is that in case of bacterial infection, we have very, very high fever. While in case of amoebic dysentery, maybe you have a low fever or moderate fever. And it's possible that you have no fever at all. That's how you differentiate a dysentery caused by a parasite and a dysentery caused by the bacteria. So the infection is caused, we name it as amoebic dysentery. Do you have any question? As far as the morphology is concerned, the parasite has a direct life cycle and it exists in two forms. One form is the trophozoite and the other one is the cyst. What is a trophozoite? Any volunteer? What is direct life cycle? Direct life cycle means when there is no involvement of any intermediate host. Only one host is involved. For example, in case of amoeba, what happens that the amoeba stays in the large intestine. And eventually some of those trophozoites, they will develop into the cyst form and those cysts, they move out. And once they are out of the body of human, the cyst will spend time in the environment, but those cysts, they will not going to invade any intermediate host. Rather, once again, once those cysts, they got mature, through contaminated hands, through contaminated water, through contaminated food. Now those, if the same species eventually will going to engulf those cysts. And now along from the stomach, it reaches to the small intestine, from the small intestine, it reaches to the large intestine and eventually start living there. So there is no involvement of any intermediate host. So if we name it those parasites where we do not have any involvement of intermediate host, we do not have any involvement of any vector, we name that life cycle is that they have a direct life cycle. Where we have the involvement of vectors, where we have the involvement of intermediate host, we name them as they have an indirect life cycle. Do you have any question regarding this?
Yes, sir.
So entamoeba-histolytica has a direct life cycle, and there are two forms. One is the trophozoites and other one is cyst. Can anyone tell me what is trophozoite? Good morning, you are all silent. I cannot speak to a computer for 1 hour. Tell me, what is trophozoite? Are you listening?
Yes, sir, we are listening.
Then please answer. It's a request, it's a humble request.
Sir, I don't know what is trophozoite.
Trophozoite is the, so I will going to tell you and remember it for rest of your life. Trophozoite is the main feeding form of parasite. While cyst is the form in which the parasite is not feeding, it's not active. Rather, cyst, it uses that form to survive in harsh environment. So trophozoite, the main growing and the feeding form of parasite. Is it? No. Do you have any questions? Someone unmuted the mic. Please ask if you have any question. Sakib bhai, you are too late. Good morning.
Oh, sorry, sir. Good morning.
No issue.
Class khatam ho gaya, sir.
I think it's over. So class dismissed.
Sorry,
no issue. No issue.